Sunrise, June 9th, 1986. Sunset, November 17th, 2018. Hopefully everyone has received an order of service and we will follow it as it has been printed. We have a hymn today, "It Is Well With My Soul," the prayer of our Reverend Dr. Carolyn Williams, the Old Testament scripture, Psalm 91, we read by Reverend William Gibson, Assistant Vice Provost at the University of Pennsylvania, and the New Testament scripture will be by Reverend Deborah Waters, 2 Corinthians 5, verses 1 through 10. Let us on today lift our eyes into the hills, from whence cometh our help, knowing that our help cometh from the Lord.
Thank you. Oh God, into your presence we come. We come, oh God, in Jesus' name, thanking you for being able to celebrate the life of this your child. We praise you, God, because your word says, blessed are the saints that die in the Lord. And Master, as we come this day that you ordained a long time ago, we pray that you would minister to your people. We pray, oh God, for the comforting power of the Holy Ghost for her mom and for her family. We know that you're a God who's able to fill every void in our lives. And we thank you for the memories that will always be kept alive. So God, we pray in Jesus' name that you would dwell in this place. Give us what we need this day. Let the joy of the Lord radiate in our hearts. And we want to say thank you for allowing Erica to pass this way and to be a very integral part of our lives. You be glorified this day. We worship you. We praise you. We magnify you. We glorify you. We exalt you because we know that underneath us are your everlasting arms. In Jesus' name, amen.
In the Old Testament, the hymn book of Israel, 91st division, found these words: He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress. My God, in him I will trust.
All right.
Surely he shall deliver thee from the snare of the fowler and from the noise of pestilence. He shall cover thee with his feathers, and under his wing shalt thou trust. His truth shall be thy shield and buckler. Thou shalt not be afraid for the terror by night, nor the arrow that flieth by day, nor for the pestilence that walketh in darkness, nor for the destruction that wasteth at noonday. Thousands shall fall at thy side, and 10,000 at thy right hand, but it shall not come nigh thee. Only with thine eyes shalt thou behold and see the reward of the wicked, because thou hast made the Lord, which is my refuge, even the Most High, thy habitation. There shall no evil befall thee, neither shall any plague come nigh thy dwelling. He shall give his angels charge over thee, to keep thee in all thy ways. They shall bear thee up in their hands, lest thou dash thy foot against a stone. Thou shalt tread upon the lion and adder. The young lion and the dragon shalt thou trample under feet, because he hath set his love upon me. Therefore I will deliver him. I will set him on high, because he hath known my name. He shall call upon me, and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him. With long life I will satisfy him, show him my salvation. This, saints, is the word of the Lord.
We have a building of God,
A house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. For it is this we groan and weep earnestly, desiring to be clothed upon with our house, which is from heaven. If so be that, being clothed, we shall not be found naked. For we that are in this tabernacle do groan, being burdened, not for that we would be unclothed, but clothed upon that morality might be swallowed up of life. Now he that hath brought us for the selfsame thing is God, who also hath given us unto the earnest of the Spirit. Therefore we are always confident, knowing that whilst we are at home and in the body, we are absent with the Lord. For we walk by faith and not by sight. We are confident, I say, willing rather to be absent with the body is to be present with the Lord. Wherefore, we labor that whether present or absent, we may be accepted of him. For we must not all appear before the judgment seat, but we must appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that everyone may receive the thing done in his body, according to that he hath done, whether it be good or bad. The word of the Lord for the people.
Thank you.
touch sanctuary choir. I am healed. We have persons listed for reflections, and I ask that you use the microphone to my right. And if you will go in this order, Sister Deanna Pitts, Sister Milana Jones, and then we'll conclude with Reverend Dr. Carolyn Williams. Sister Pitts.
I know that many of you have traveled a long way just to be here in honor of this sweet, wonderful person I'm about to call my sister. Erica was only 32 years old when she left us. She has so much life and love to give. But I guess God had other plans. My father, Bruce, never made a separation between the two of us. He loved us both equally. Therefore, making it easier for me to also incorporate my sister, Raven. So I had a bonus, one born of my mother, and also one born of my father. Erica, I pray that I served you well, and I made you proud. Although this is tragic, it's extremely hard for us. Erica would have wanted for us to keep our spirits high, because that's who she was. I'm forever blessed to have spent the past years of my life with you. Rest in peace, baby girl, and you'll always be in my heart.
Amen.
Y'all doing a good day. This is an extremely difficult time for all of us. Erica, Jesus. She was the orchestrator. She played the time where everybody was going to be at the shop where I work at, and you know, trying to get everybody together, trying to get us there on time. But you know, people didn't really know me. I'm always late for anything. So we had to go home, go to my house, and get ready and everything. And you know, Erica wasn't doing her best at that time, but she always tried to make sure that she took care of everybody else. And made sure that everybody else felt good. She was like, sis, I'm going to help you drive. I was like, you sure? She was like, yeah, I'm going to help you drive. So before we could get good on 20, she was going to sleep. And I was like, oh my God, like, I thought she was going to help me drive. But okay, let me pull over and get me a Red Bull. Because I had worked the whole week and I was tired. We went to the Fort Valley, it was raining, just like it is today. It was pouring down raining, and we got there, we walked in the rain. It was my niece and one of my adopted daughters, Amy, and we were walking in the rain just to go see the game. Now, the game was horrible, but it didn't matter because we were together. And it was fun, it was laughs, it was everything to us. And then she was like, sis, I'm gonna help you drive on the way back. I said, all right, girl, all right, cool, all right. So we get in the car. Erica got on the passenger side and got her blanket and went back to sleep. And I said, well, goodness gracious. And I sat there and looked there and I said, well, I just let her rest. And on another occasion is when, like a couple weeks ago, she was here over in that section, and she was just sitting over there, and I asked Michelle, I was like, where's Erica? Because anytime I come from Raising Generation, I'm always looking for Erica. And I said, Erica, I said, where's Erica? She was like, she over there on the side, you haven't talked to her. So this was coming up to Halloween, and she was like, I said, sis, what's wrong with you? She's like, I don't feel good, sis, I don't feel good. And I said, well, you know, we gotta do something about that. You know, we gotta go to the hospital. We gotta go. And she's like, I don't wanna go. I said, why you don't wanna go? Because I'm not gonna be able to trick or treat. I said, well, trick or treat? I said, well, everybody, you know, did their trick or treat the weekend before, because it's during the week. She's like, all right, sis, I'm gonna go ahead and go. And my last memory of her was, it was on a Tuesday. In the last about three months, we have lost three, including Erica, of our SPC youth choir members. And for St. Philip youth choir members, it's been very difficult because we're still mourning the loss of those other two. And Erica was in the hospital, and she called me to check on me to see if I was all right. And I said, Erica, I was like, girl, I'm gonna check on you, just to check on you, and just to see if I could come and see you. But Erica, no matter what she was going through, she always tried to make sure everybody else was all right. And, you know, even though that she was, you know, hurting and pain and just suffering, she still was like, you know, y'all just pray for me. Just pray for me, God got me. And I'm all right. But how are you doing? And that's what I'm gonna always take from Erica, that no matter what we're going through, no matter what we're going through, we still got God first. He's always ahead of our life, no matter what we're going through. It's a tough and difficult time, but He's here with us during this tough time. He's never gonna leave us. He's right by my side, and right by His side is Angel Erica. Erica, I love you.
In Luke, the 8th chapter, Jesus tells a story about a sower who went out to sow seed. And it talks about the different grounds that the seed fell on. Some fell by the wayside, some fell on the rocks, some fell among thorns, and other on good ground. Well, Jesus' disciples did not understand it thoroughly, so He explained it to them and simply said, the seed is the word of God. When I pondered my relationship with Erica, the Lord took me to get some seeds and reminded me of a few things for which I give Him praise. First of all, He allowed me to be one of the sowers in her life. As her youth pastor from childhood, even to a few days ago, and I must admit that I watched the seed fall on good ground in a receptive heart and flourish. You see, I believe from my conversations with her that she learned some things about seeds. A seed is alive and contains life, but it does nothing until it's planted. So she decided to plant the word of God in her heart. And oftentimes I would ask her, do you love Jesus? She said, yes, Reverend Carolyn, I love Jesus. Do you love His word? Yes, I love His word. Secondly, a seed is much smaller than the plant it produces. The problem you face may be huge, but in comparison to the seed of the word when planted, it grows in you and overcomes the problem.
Right.
A seed is persistent. It never gives up, but works night and day. Erica was persistent. A seed is not affected by other seeds. Whatever happens to other seeds does not make any difference to a specific seed. It sticks to its own task, and it does not become discouraged or quit, even when other seeds do. A seed is powerful. As it begins to grow, it's got to push up the dirt, the rocks, and etc. Whatever the obstacles are, the word of God planted in your heart will push them out of the way. A planted seed produces a harvest. We reap because she reaped. Lastly, a seed will stop growing without nourishment. Seeds must be protected. They must be taken care of until harvest time. So this morning, I salute you, Sister Michelle, for a job well done with the seed that God gave you. Well, today God has prepared a place in his flower bed just for Erica. And she is a brightly shining flower, displaying that radiant smile and quiet spirit in his presence. And I thank God for the opportunity to be one of those who sowed the word of God in her life, his seed in her life. And so this morning, Erica, I will always love you. And to you, Sister Michelle, I'll give you these bright, flowering seeds, for you have done a mighty good job. God bless you.
We certainly want to thank each and every person for their beautiful words, humorous, touching, and definitely heartfelt. At this time, we have a musical tribute from Sister Shamika Banks, followed by our video tribute, and then Reverend Janice McCray will come forth with our resolution.
Yeah. Thank you.
the late Sister Erica Green. When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is well with my soul. Whereas words are inadequate to express our sympathy in the passing of your loved one, know that we, the ministers, officers, and members of the St. Philip AME Church, share in your sorrow. Whereas God, in his infinite wisdom, has called from the labors of this life to the rewards of heaven the soul of Sister Erica Green, daughter of Sister Michelle Walker. Whereas we look to God, the author and finisher of our faith, for comfort, knowing he is too wise to err and too just to falter, and is always by our side. Know that our hearts and our prayers will be with the family, for only God is able to strengthen and sustain you during this difficult time. Be it resolved that we bow in humble submission to the will of Almighty God, and we commend her spirit to God. And finally, be it resolved that this resolution is given to the family and a copy be placed in the files of the church. Prayerfully submitted, the Reverend Dr. William D. Watley, Senior Pastor. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Reverend Gray. Now, Brother Osby, if you will come forward for our acknowledgments. Then we have a beautiful solo by Sister Latanya Moore Copeland, and then words of comfort from our illustrious pastor. Amen.
Praise the Lord, everybody. The family of Erica Green thanks you for helping write the last chapter of her story here on earth. Your generosity, your time, your prayers, and your efforts have not gone unnoticed. It's during these times that we realize our beloved has impacted so many lives, and that you thought it not robbery to celebrate her legacy with us today. You have blessed us tremendously. May God bless you all. Thank you.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Praise the Lord, everybody. Amen. Michelle and family and church, we just wanted you to know, on behalf of the Worship Arts Ministry here at St. Philip AME Church, the choir consists of members of all of our choirs. Michelle, you have been such a blessing to everybody, and we wanted to pour back into you on today. And so when the call went forth, the people answered. So we wanted you to know, on behalf of the Worship Arts Ministry, we are here, we love you, and support you. Thank you.
Oh, 45:46. Now from the sixth hour until the ninth hour, there was darkness over all the land. About the ninth hour, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, saying, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, that is, my God, why have you forsaken me? My God, why? You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. There were a lot of questions floating around Calvary that day. Chief among them was one that was not uttered, but felt in the hearts of many of those who had gathered. My God, my God, why? Such a powerful, righteous Savior did nothing but good, spoke nothing but the truth, claimed sonship to Almighty God, the Creator of heaven and earth. Here he was, stretched out between a sorrowing heaven and a sinning earth, dying at the hands of wicked and evil people. My God, my God, why? He served you. You could have had the power to stop that. Why would you allow such a bright, articulate, faithful young life to be snuffed out before he reached his prime? My God, my God, why? Can't you see Mary, his mother, as she stood there looking at the delight of her eyes put into her by the anointing of the Holy Spirit, carried and then given birth in very trying circumstances in a barn, wrapped him in swaddling clothes, nurtured him, watched him, and now as he suffers and dies, my God, my God, why? Can't you see faithful disciples who had left all to follow him and had believed that he was the consolation of Israel and God's very anointed to redeem us, as they looked at the Savior that they had lived and fellowship with and followed for 3 long years of their reputation and mockery of their friends? Now it all seems so lost and futile. My God, my God, why? Hear him as he looks around him and at the brightest part of the day sees nothing but darkness and cries out, my God, my God, why? There were a lot of questions floating around the Calvary, and I would venture to guess there are a lot of questions floating around St. Philip on December the 1st, 2018. Young woman saved, nurtured, loved, talented, bright, vivacious, charming. My God, my God, why? I know that sometimes we're not to question God. And faith at its best could assert that we're willing, content to just say it's the Lord's will. But religion is not about religion. Religion is a relationship. And if you have a relationship with somebody, sometimes things will come up and you gotta talk through and question. See, religion is not about religion, it's helping you structure and define a relationship with a living God. And so it's all right when things don't make sense to us. Ask, my God, my God, why? And what is interesting is that sometimes the answer doesn't come right away. Faith doesn't mean that you can just, the name of Jesus is not some magic wand that you can wave and automatically revelation will come and breakthrough will make its appearance through the dark clouds. Faith means that there is a season when you gotta live with your my God, why? Before the answers come. Well, tell me, preacher, now that we're sitting here, how do we live faithful when the my God, why answer hasn't come? Let us never forget that this prayer that some people define as a prayer of despair, their religion that Jesus prayed on Calvary, didn't just come off of his head, it came from Psalm 22:1. In other words, he prayed the scriptures. That sometimes when things happen and we don't understand, what we have to do is grab a word and hold on to it. Thou wilt keep him in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on thee. Grab your word and hold on to it. We know that all things work together for good to them who love God, for those who are called according to his purpose. Grab your word and hold on to it. Steadfast love of the Lord never leaves. His faithfulness never comes to an end. They are new and fresh every morning, even in the midst of my God. Wow. Great is God. To grab your word and hope, for he gives power to the faint. And to him who has no might, he increases their strength. Even you shall fall and be weary, and the young shall fall exhausted. But they that wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. Pray, hold on to your word. And if I can use an old Pentecostal term, you have to pray through. My God, my God, why? Continue to keep, at least in the question, to keep the lines of communication open. Some people run away and hide and in fright. No. God has not given us a spirit of fear. Some people become angry. You don't want to become angry because that's like biting a hand that feeds you. Some things only the strength of God can take you through. My God, my God. And that question was an answer. Women went away and were faithful and prepared early Sunday morning while it was still dark to anoint a body to they had seen God. But when they got to the place of burial, there was no answer, but there was a living presence. An angel who told them, he is not here. He has risen. And so the prayer was answered not in words, but with a revelation of God's eternal power, that when you live in him and die in him, you shall be raised in him. Power that keeps and sustains and is faithful and wipes tears from your eyes and give you strength that you didn't know you had to make it through this season. Well, that same God works the same way. You may not hear him whispering to you while Erica is now with him, because that's what we believe. And sometimes life has a way of forcing us to stand by what we say. If we believe that when this earth lives, the tent we live in is destroyed, we have another building, house not made in hand. If we believe that he's going away, he's coming again when our home is ready to prepare a place for us to receive him, and that we will be forever with the Lord. He hadn't done anything to her but keep his word. And to us, he gives the presence that only a true and living God, that if you can pray your way through the darkness, weeping does endure for a night. But joy, and I know you know him because of the way you celebrate at this homegoing service. People who love the Lord don't need to fall out and cry and whine and be carried out. Sometimes that's more guilt than grief anyway. But if you know that you've done the best you can and your loved one is with the Lord, then you, with weeping eyes, can hold your head up and say that I don't know everything, but this much I know. I know that my Redeemer liveth, that he shall stand at the latter day upon the earth, and though these skin worms destroy this body, yet in my flesh shall I see God, whom mine eyes shall behold, and not another. Until then, we lean and depend on the Jesus who lives now and forevermore. During this season, we're especially reminded, as we walk through the turbulent times with unanswered questions, God sent his son. They called him Jesus. He came to love, heal and forgive. He lived and died. To buy my heart, an empty grave is there to prove my Savior lived. Because he lived, Michelle and the other members of this family, you can face tomorrow. But because he lived, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds victory. Future life is worth the living. Just because our Savior lives. Now, the laborer's task is over. Now, the battle day is past. Now, upon the farther shore lands the voyager at last. Father, into thy gracious keeping, leave we now thy servant, Erica, sleeping. Servant of God. Young servant of God. Welcome. Rest from thy loving shining as the sun, with no less days to sing God's praise than when we first begun. I need everybody to just shout this. Amen. Shout it again. Shout it one more time. Amen means it is so.
Never come to an end. For as a father pities his children, so the Lord pities those who fear him. Say to those who are fearful of heart, be strong, fear not, behold, your God will come and save you. For as much as the spirit of the departed hath returned to God who gave it, therefore commit her body to the ground, earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust, looking for the general resurrection in the last day and the life of the world to come. At whose coming in glorious majesty to judge the world, the earth, and the sea shall give up their dead, and the corruptible bodies of those who sleep in him shall be changed, made like unto his own glorious body according to the mighty working, whereby he is able to subdue all things into himself. And I heard a voice from heaven saying unto me, write, from henceforth blessed are the dead who die in the Lord, that they may rest from their labors, and their works do follow them. Lord, have mercy upon us. Lord, have mercy upon us. Let us pray the prayer our Lord has taught us. Our Father, take place immediately after this service. Those of you who may not be familiar with this edifice, what center door, turn to your right until you get to the first large hallway and go down to the left, and that's where the family will be happy to greet you. Now, may grace, peace, and mercy from God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit rest, rule, and abide with you now and forevermore. Amen.